And so therefore, if you say, well, I would like to become like that, that's an expression of the way you are. You couldn't feel, I would like to become like that, like the authority, like the Christ, except as an expression of the way you are now. And the way you are now is the quaking mess. And therefore, your emulation, your desire, your idealism to become like Christ is merely one of the appetites of your quaking mess. It's an expression of you as you are. And don't fool yourselves. I'm not trying to put you down by talking about the quaking mess. The quaking mess may be, in fact, something very, very natural. The way we are, the state of affairs, and we shouldn't be ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed of it. I told you I was frantic. But it is important not to fool oneself about this. But there does, doesn't there, seem to remain a problem about existence, about being alive. Now let's go into what is that problem. Ideals are simply manifestations of the quaking mess, trying to get away from itself, and that you are put in the position of, it is absolutely necessary for me to be different from the way I am, but there's absolutely nothing I can do about it, because being the way I am, I cannot be different from. Let's say this, and then we can put it in different ways. I know that I ought not to be selfish, and I would very much like to be an unselfish person, but the reason why I want to be an unselfish person is that I am very selfish and would far more love myself and respect myself if I were unselfish. See? And yet something has to be done. Obviously. But you realize, when you really look into yourself, there's nothing you can do. And this, therefore, is our point of departure. That we here, perhaps not, mutually realize there is nothing we can do to be anything else than what we are. To feel any other way than what we feel at this moment. And to be then this quaking mess which has the capacity for the horrors about what life produces. However, this isn't as much of a blind alley, a cul-de-sac, as it sounds. Because if you discover a blind alley, it tells you something. Watch the flow of water when it crosses over an area of land, and you will see that it puts out fingers, and some of them stop because they come into blind alleys. The water doesn't pursue that course. It simply rises, and then it finds a way it can go. But it never uses any effort. It only uses weight, gravity. Line of least resistance and eventually finds a course. Now we will do the same thing. Only we're ashamed of it, but we're going to do it anyhow. We think that when we come to a dead end, a blind alley, oh, I failed. Supposing the water at each place where a finger of water stretches out over dry ground and doesn't go any further because the land is too high, the water were to say to itself, I've failed. We would say it was neurotic water. Just wait, and it will find a way. Now, when you find, you see, that there's this predicament that I've been describing to you, that there's no way of transforming yourself to become this fearless, joyous, divine being as distinct from the waking mass. When is there's no way, this is not a gloomy announcement. It is a very, very important communication. It's telling you something. Because like the land is telling the water, this isn't the way to go. There's another way. Try over here. So in the same way, life is telling you that's not the way to go. It's telling you. The message underlying this is you cannot transform yourself is giving you the message that the you that you imagine to be capable of transforming yourself doesn't exist. Thank you. In other words, an ego, an I, separate from my emotions, my thoughts, my feelings, my experiences, who is supposed to be in control of, cannot control them because it isn't there. And as soon as you understand that, things will be vastly improved.
If you're intelligent and you live past 40, you will outgrow your culture. I mean, some people may do it sooner, but you have to be a complete idiot to just buy in at 55, at 60, at 75, at 80. You know, what are you still going to be doing? Expressing homophobic views, voting Republican, and worrying about the A, B, and C's of phony reality? I mean, most people get to a place where they just see it's a bunch of crap. Scandals are recycled, the philosophical issues are recycled, the technical innovations are recycled. Once you've been through about three cycles of this, you realize that, you know, this is a media-created state of cultural involvement and reciprocal narcissism, only to be assuaged by the expenditure of money, and that you can just walk away from it. It's unnecessary.
today's world, you will never see a government telling the population in their country that we want you to be your own men, your own women. We want you to think for yourself. They won't say that. On the contrary, they will say, this is what we think you should think. This is what we think you should say. This is what we think you should do. And this is how we want you to live. We need to fight that. We need to fight it. Because freedom is not... I've said it before and I'll say it again. Freedom is not the natural state of a society. If the people in that society, if the population are lazy, freedoms will vanish. Being kind to people, being generous, is it's a sign of a strong individual.
Seems to be accelerating with each hour. There has been a marked change in the selectivity over the past 3 hours.
Being your own man means that you try, you do your best, and you take responsibility for the shortcomings. And you follow your own path. There are many aspects. Your financial life is one very important part of it. Getting out of debt, I would say, should be a goal. Don't buy stuff all the time. It's amazing how cheap you can live.
Seems to be accelerating with each hour.
has been a marked change in selectivity over the past 3 hours.
A man who is his own man, who thinks for himself, who has his goals, his ambitions, who kneels for no man. He's a dangerous man. I'm saying that because he's viewed by society, maybe, the government, maybe, as a dangerous man. But in reality, if all men are like that, we will have a much better and healthier and kinder society.
Sense, all addiction and repeated behaviours is an attempt to provide a kind of regulation, a sort of self-evoked parentheses to hold me in the horror of this world, in a world that doesn't provide us with enough structures and systems and comforts. When someone said to me once, well done you, how clever of you to become a heroin addict, how you found a way out, you found a way of dealing with your feelings. In a sense, any of us that have got some behaviour that's no longer working for us should be applauded for at least attempting to make life manageable. But the problem is, that behaviour is no longer working. It has to be arrested, it has to be addressed. Now, we tentatively, somewhat timidly, embark on a journey of hope. It's pretty frightening. It's frightening to be a drug addict and put down drugs. It's frightening to be a codependent person and say, no, I'm going to relate to my partner differently now. These changes mean that you are confronted by the fear that you were trying to avoid by indulging in that behaviour in the first place. That's why something as seemingly parochial and mundane as not looking at my phone, for me, can be a sort of, like, slices open the intestines of my self-obsession and dread of the world. Suddenly, here I am, eviscerated, confronted with, oh my God, the reason you're looking at your phone is because you can't bear to be you. The reason you're masturbating is because you can't bear to be you. The reason you're thinking, if I get that rise, if I get that job, if I make that movie, oh, it's because you can't bear to be you. And there's a reason that you can't bear to be you, and that's because there is no you. The entire thing is a construct made up of biochemical drives and memory. Not that you're not a unique and wonderful human individual, as unique as your own fingerprint. Of course you are. The whole point of 12-step recovery is to recover the person you were intended to be. That assumes that there wasn't innate teleology that you were embarking upon as surely as a seed becomes a tree. No one would question that ordinary miracle, but encapsulated there within the acorn is the miracle of the mighty oak. None of us questions that, and few oak trees in their adolescent sapling stage have some overbearing father or negligent mother barking at them that they're too fat or they're not good enough or they'll never be as good as their brother tree. The journey of recovery takes you back to a place where you recognize that you were going somewhere, that there is a better version of you. This is the beauty and the optimism of this program, that you are not worthless, that your own belief that you are worthless is as much as an illusion that you could make yourself happy with a life of endless Ferraris and blowjobs. We know that's an illusion now, particularly if you're a fragile and awkward driver such as myself. I struggle anyway, even when I'm trying to stay bang on that highway code. A few twitches in the region of the groin is the last thing I need. Straight into the crash barriers. So, is it about hope? Is it about positivity? Is the acceptance that there is a better you waiting to be born?
Very much human nature. Of course, we've gotten soft as a culture in the US because has had an incredible 200-year run, right? Like, this is just what happens, you know. So as a culture, you know, I can't speak for, you know, people that live in the Amazon River, and I can't speak for, you know, people that still live in Belarus, but the American culture is soft, and that's a great thing. That means there's been enormous amounts of prosperity, but let's not be naive. I mean, people literally complain when somebody gives them the wrong amount of like extra cream in a Starbucks $6 coffee. Of interest in complaining is so high, and when I watch what people complain about, it breaks my heart because they completely lack perspective. And I genuinely believe my happiness and optimism comes from my perspective. Even in political unrest times like right now, a lot of people are very bent out of shape, but the reality is that it's just never been better to be a human being. That's just the truth, that's just data, that's reality. So I have a lot of wealthy friends at this point who think it's smart for them to sit first class, but the kids can coach. It's a tactic. They send their kids to Africa to build a school for a week. It's a tactic. It's like my friends that love the environment. The number two sector in the world that is hurting the environment is the fashion industry. When you run the math of what's doing bad to the earth, it's the number two industry behind gas. I don't even want to say it because I'm not sure if it's gas and oil. The number two industry, this I know for a fact, is the fashion industry. So all my fancy friends who love the environment, are they willing to give up their fucking Louis bags? Let's see, right? So like, I think people talk shit. So you let them sit coach and you went first class, but you went to, you know, Hawaii and ate at all the best places. Like, you can't pick and choose. To me, it's binary. So I don't want to be a hypocrite. So my big thing is like, look, you need to be kind. For other people is a good strategy. I've been like trying to forget, like, I'm like, why does this thing even exist? It's actually the most common sense thing of all time. Why does karma seem weird? The fuck is karma? Like, wait a minute, so you're telling me like if you do lots of good things that weirdly good things happen to you? Yeah, that seems like common sense. Beating ourselves up. Like, everybody sucks at something, right? Like, we all have shortcomings and we all have strengths. And for me, it's like, why don't we just audit that? Like, why don't we just look at it that way and be like, all right, well, I'm good at this, but I'm not good at that. Like, and then I only focus what I'm good at, right? Like, I don't dwell that I can't fix shit around the house. I call somebody to fix it. Like, I'm not like, I'm not a man. I don't give a fuck. Like, you know, like, I don't get it. Like, we all, like, I also think it's awesome that I'm so emotionally stable and I'm the emotional backbone of everybody. Is that what a dude's supposed to do? Like these cliches, these stereotypes, they're so silly. You're exactly right, man. I don't judge myself. I'm fully in love with myself. But I'm also fully in love with everybody else too, right? It's not like it goes both ways. Like, I tell people to buy into me, that work for me, it's because I buy into them first. Like, I don't need anybody to gain trust with me. It's there. Like, I believe that the human race is so grossly underrated. We are good. Of course we have some bad. There's fucking 7 billion of us. But like, when you look at our net score, it's bonkers shit. Like, do you know how much damage we could be doing to each other on an hourly basis, and we don't? Like, we're still here. Like, we won. We're the alpha being, and we've figured out how to stay together. This is insane when you think about it. And yet everybody wants to dwell on, like, somebody said something mean.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on a mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings. How eager they are to kill one another. How fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
Thank you. The fact that people argue with me on this reading thing, and people argue with me about mentors. No, just use your own gut feeling. Is that how you learn English? When you were 2 years old, you used your gut feeling to start conjugating verbs? No, you learn from other people. You learn manners, you learn language, you learn all things valuable.
Any improvement at all over time, any improvement, 1%, 0.1%, just extend the time frame, make it 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years. The universe is 13.8 billion years old. Civilization, if you count it, if you're very generous, civilization is maybe 7 or 8,000 years old, if you count it from the first writing. This is nothing. This is nothing. If you assume any rate of improvement at all, then games will be indistinguishable from reality. Or civilization will end. One of those two things will occur. Sound like things are too dark, because I think like you kind of have to be optimistic about the future. There's no point in being pessimistic. It's just too negative. It doesn't help, you know. I think you want to be, I mean, my theory is like you'd rather be optimistic. I'd rather be optimistic and wrong than pessimistic and right. Because if you're pessimistic, it's going to be miserable.
Someone's gonna bottle it, put a fragrance to it, sell it. French people in another dimension.
It's just a very long time. Yeah. So I think it's really just about how can we make it last longer. I think most likely, this is just about probability, there are many, many simulations. These simulations are, you might as well call them reality, or you could call them multiverse. Well, when we create a simulation, like a game or a movie, it's a distillation of what's interesting about life. You know, like it takes a year to shoot an action movie, and then that's all distilled down into 2 or 3 hours. So, let me tell you, if you see an action movie being filmed, it's boring. Super boring. There's like lots of takes, everything's in a green screen. Looks pretty goofy, doesn't look cool. But once you add the CGI and have great editing, it's amazing. So, I think most likely, if we're a simulation, it's really boring outside the simulation. Why would you make a simulation that's boring? It'd make a simulation way more interesting than base reality.
Say, make it simple. A cold shower a day keeps the doctor away. That's it.
Start having cold showers.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. And take a warm one later, but first a cold one. Dave Asprey, in his podcast, he asked me, Wim, I never asked this question. What do you think of enlightenment? And please put it in one sentence. Bibles and Qurans written on that shit. So I came with the... I got it. Just be happy, strong, and healthy, and the rest is bullshit. So that bullshit, the way we are defending and carrying, we are not light but dark, we are not light but heavy. That shit needs to go. And ask yourself every morning, are you happy, strong, and healthy? Are you going for your dream vision? Are you going for your state of your subconscious? Are you learning how to make full usage of your own mind so the spirit is able to grow and your soul is able to shine like the sun? And it's there, because the rest is bullshit if you don't. Metaphysically and metadynamically, Big Bang, that's the most stupid thing in the world, existence. It all began with the Big Bang. What are you talking about? It's a big fart of the universe or what? And then life like we are began. There is simply a matter which we are not able to measure with the devices we have. And that gets into matter. And when that matter comes, then we are able to work with our consciousness on that matter to bring it back to that state wherein it was. And now release it to get back into that state. And there is the soul. There is the beautiful soul, which is immortal and indestructible. There we find a relief of the fear and the concept of what is death.
Eat clean. So get a healthy diet plan and stick to it. And why you want to do this is that, first of all, eating better food will give you more energy. And it will also make you healthier. You'll live longer. And you'll be more productive. You'll look better. Everything is better when you're healthy. So there is no valid argument for not eating healthy. I mean, who would want to live shorter and live a shittier existence and look worse and feel worse and do worse work and do everything worse? Like, who would want that? That makes no sense, right? So you should eat clean. time management. So plan your months, weeks, days, and hours deliberately and stick to it and say no to everything that isn't in the plan. And you have to be relentless with this. Will you upset some people? Yes. Will people think that you're not a nice person? Probably. Will people think, oh, that you should make exceptions? Yes. But do we care? No. Because, you know, the world around us, like most people in society, they're trying to pacify us. You know, they're trying to just numb our senses, and they're trying to make us feel for them and listen to them and hear their voices and all of this crap. And they're trying to make you behave and think like everyone else. They're basically just trying to pacify you and cut you down to size and make you fit in. And you can't have that, because normal gets normal. And if you're, what you're pursuing isn't normal, then it's going to take abnormal to get abnormal. And so you have to not care about that. Just stay true to your goal. Nobody knows. Success equals sacrifice. And you can't have it all. And if you don't sacrifice for what you want becomes the sacrifice. So how bad do you want it? Now, people often talk a big game and say they're hungry, but as soon as you get them to sacrifice something they care about, they reveal their true character and their true priorities. You know, the best test I've got for people is just whether they will sacrifice something. And if they don't, then you know exactly where their priorities lie. But if they're willing to give up everything, you know where their priorities lie too. Created a lie in your head that this thing is necessary and that your business and you need it. The word you're probably saying is, I need it, Sam, I need it. You don't. You know, there's some things you don't want to sacrifice. You don't want to sacrifice sleep. You need at least 7 hours a night. You don't sacrifice that. And you also need good food and exercise and meditation. You don't sacrifice those things because that's your health, and without your health you don't exist, and so nothing else matters if you don't exist, right? So that's number one priority. We don't sacrifice that. And then we also need, you know, a relationship in our family. Without that, you know, then a very primal part of our brain won't be able to focus on financial things and on a business and on future things, because it's more concerned with its primal need right now. And you need a loving relationship, because without these things your limbic system will play havoc with you and harm your focus. But, you know, one thing that's kind of a bit hard to swallow for a lot of family people is that a lot of the time they need to actually spend less time with their family to really achieve the things that they want to achieve. And that's a dark place some people don't want to go. But it's just the way it is. You know, I'm not saying you have to neglect your family. But, you know, there's some people who spend a ton of time with their family. Like, they're literally always doing something. Dropping the kids off, picking them up, doing this project with them, going here, going on this trip over here. And it's like, it's really demanding. And if you want to do that, then that's cool, do it. But just know that you can't really do that and chase your vision if your vision's big. If your vision's small, then yeah, you can balance both. But if your vision's big and you think you can do both, then you're kind of lying to yourself, you know? And you need to just understand this and be real with it and, you know, take yourself to that dark place and face it honestly and make a proper decision about what you want to do. You know, people want to tell you their story. People want to talk to you. People want you to care about what they've got to say, and people want you to understand them. And, you know, all of these people everywhere all want something. They're very needy. They want your time. They want your attention. They think they know what you should do. They've got all of this crap, and they're just trying to leech onto you. And the beauty of knowing your vision, mission, and principles, and your goals, and being self-aware, and knowing who you need to become, and is that you can really have the self-discipline to just ignore pretty much everything. So you just ignore it.
To me, you define a warrior as someone who's willing to do battle with the resistance in their own mind, or the parasite of their mind, to use the Toltec language. And that's someone who's willing to show up and not do battle necessarily externally, but do battle internally and reconcile those things that are not serving them and admit those things and go into the shadow and be willing to go into your inmost cave. Find out what dragons lay there and find out where your deepest fears and insecurities are. Like, that's a warrior to me. And so the warrior ethos is a commitment to do that. It's a commitment to say, as soon as you see an area where you realize you're out of balance, or see an area where there's things that are scary or you're insecure, that you go towards those things. You know, that you don't allow those things to rule you, you know? And I think it's that willingness to go into the cave and go into the shadow that defines a warrior. And, you know, I think that's really key. And ultimately using the desire to be fit for service so that you can be of service is also the secondary part of the warrior ethos. It's this idea that I have to take care of me so that I can take care of anybody else. Because if you're not taking care of yourself, you're not going to be able to take care of anybody.
We are small, finite beings, right, which are just clusters of atoms. As we said before, they're very rare, but we understand roughly how they came to be. And we have a limited amount of time, not actually unfortunately, but because of the laws of nature. And the laws of nature forbid us to be immortal. They immortality is ruled out by the laws of physics. But also, actually, what's interesting about, if you look at the basic physics of the universe, going from the Big Bang to where we are today, then the physics is driven by the fact that the universe began in an extremely ordered state. So it was a very highly ordered system. And it is tending towards a more disordered system at the moment. And that's called the second law of thermodynamics. And it's that basic common sense thing that things go to shit, right? It's basically it's the second law of thermodynamics. What we strongly suspect, and I would say no, is that in that process of going from order to disorder, complexity emerges naturally for a brief period of time. So it's a natural part of the evolution of the universe that you get a period in time when there's complexity in the universe. So stars and planets and galaxies and life and civilizations. But they exist because the universe is decaying, not in spite of the fact the universe is decaying. So our existence in that sort of picture is necessarily finite and necessarily time limited. And it is a remarkable thing that that complexity has got so far that there are things in the universe that can think and feel and explore it. And I think that is the answer. If you want an answer to the meaning of it all, it's that. That you are part of the universe because of the way the laws of nature work. You are allowed to exist, but you're allowed to exist for a temporary, or for a small amount of time, in a possibly infinite universe.
If you take these neurotransmitters, these exopheromones that connect you up with the natural environment, the Gaian intent becomes known. Abstraction, excuses, incredible wealth, incredible levels of pampering and softness lie between us, the upper 5% of the intellectual and material elite on the planet, and the problems. I mean, how many of us have been to Bosnia or Rwanda or Somalia? These things are only images on a dehumanizing screen. If we could feel what we are doing, we would awaken to the mystery of each other and to the mystery of the historical process of recovering what was lost. We don't need this material civilization. We don't need 5 billion people on this planet. We have to think very, very radically about how we are going to change ourselves, or we're not going to make the cut. And orthodoxy is utterly and completely bankrupt. All it can do is suppress. They suppress, they suppress, they suppress. But there's only one argument that will forgive suppression: deliverance. And they can't give us deliverance. All they can give us is the Menendez tribe. OJ, Baby M, the Skaters, Klaus von Bülow. Horseshit, horseshit, horseshit. We are locked inside a nightmare of contaminated and toxic imagery that is designed to disempower you and make it impossible for you to think straight. And the way out is straight back to the reality of the vegetable gnosis. Psychedelics, but it's also to decondition oneself to the notion of ego and all the concepts which constellate around that, such as place, property, ownership, and stability. You see, the idea that we have inherited from Western religion and science is the idea that things should be stable. This is a very male dominant notion, the wish for stability, eternity, when in fact the message life hands you over and over again is nothing lasts. Nothing lasts. Not what you love, not what you hate, not your enemies, your friends, not even your dear, dear self. Nothing lasts. And the ego goes mad in the presence of that truth. So we have anxiety of death, need to dominate people, need to possess property, terror of illness, resentment of fate, because we are not in the flow. And I think what these psychedelics do is they put you very much in the here and now.
being able to overcome ego, being able to overcome envy, being able to overcome jealousy, being able to overcome the negative of competitive state. There's a positive competitive state, and there's a negative competitive state. Today, when people are looking on Instagram or Facebook or YouTube, all you're looking at is, oh, she got that many likes, or he got that many likes, she got engaged, or he got married, or, oh my God, look at her body, or look at that. And it's like, that stuff's destroying us inside. Envy, jealousy, ego, greed. To be able to have enough clarity to purify yourself of those things is going to alleviate the biggest anxieties and depressions of our time and mental health problems. And we know that. We know that because all the mental health research today suggests that things like isolation, overexposure, we now can have more pain consumption in one day because of what we're exposed to than the pain we would have had in a lifetime. That's huge. Like that's ridiculous to think that in one day, because of the media, news and social media, we consume more negative than we did in a lifetime. For me, being able to have time, energy and clarity to focus on self-purification, that is the best thing about being a monk, because you have that time, reflection and a process and an environment that only allows you to become more purified of those things. There's a beautiful verse in the Bhagavad Gita that says that detachment is not that you own nothing. Detachment is that nothing owns you. And I love it because to me that summarizes detachment in a way that it's not usually explained. Usually people see detachment as being away from everything. Mm. Actually, the greatest detachment is being close to everything and not letting it consume and own you.
Nobody can be God. Nobody can make life any better by being responsible about it. Because whatever you gain in that direction, you lose at the same time. By being responsible, we've created civilization, medicine, care of the poor, everything. But what a headache the thing has become. As we solve all our problems, we make more problems. Every problem you solve gives you 10 new problems. I'm not saying don't do that, but don't think you're going to get anywhere by doing that. That's one way of arranging it. That's one kind of dance you can have, is to improve everything and have technology. But it doesn't really solve it. And it's only in the moment you see, when you fully understand that your situation as a human being is completely insoluble, that there is no answer, and that you give up looking for the answer, that's nirvana. And that's how Buddhism works.
I think we should take the actions, the set of actions that are most likely to make the future better, and then reevaluate those actions to make sure that it's true.
I would only take this.